America has not always presented a united front of support in times leading up to war. An opponent of American entry into World War II, North Dakota Senator Gerald P. Nye's willingness to take on President Roosevelt, the powerful munitions industry, and America's financial kingpins earned him the nickname the Giant Killer.
In some ways, it's kind of a sad legacy. Here's a man who had a chance to really make a difference, a man who could have added significance to the status of the nation, whether it was in preparedness for World War II, whether it was as a government watchdog. But Nye just couldn't quite step away. Gerald Nye was a United States Senator who was appointed to office after Senator Ladd passed away in office. He's the second youngest member of the Senate that it was seated at that time. He's only 33, but he's brash. He clearly knew how to play an audience. Some have even suggested that the way he dressed was to stir people a little bit. Because if you see pictures of him as a younger man, he's got a very unusual haircut. I believe I once read someone said it had been clearly cut by a Dutchman with a bowl. So he's kind of a backward hayseed kind of boy. You know, he's North Dakota, he's 33, and I think people underestimate him for a while. What he's best known early on for is starting the Teapot Dome investigation. At one time, probably based upon a mispronunciation of his name, they were referring to him as Gerald the Giant Killer. As the 1920s roll along, he's a man who needs a project. They say Joe McCarthy was debating between communists and dairy farm support, and he picked communists. Well, for whatever reason, rather than jumping on the agricultural bandwagon, Nye jumps on the peace initiative. And looking at the munitions industry during the First World War, nobody really wants to jump on the bandwagon to do this investigation. The economy's doing well, and nobody really seems that interested in undertaking the investigation. And ultimately, Nye does. Small committee, I think about 6 or 8 senators. And by the time they start pawing through the record books for who loaned money to whom, how much was loaned, we're also coming into the Great Depression. It's the vortex where you've got men who are out of work, men who are protesting for their bonuses after the war, but yet Henry Ford or whomever still looks kind of fat and happy. And you take the loss of your son, his physical handicaps, and someone who seems to be doing well at a time of depression, and you've got a wonderful subject to investigate. And he rides that pony. And suddenly it seems quite feasible that we had entered the war not because of freedom of the seas or not because of making the world safe for democracy, but because J.P. Morgan needed more cash.
It is not going to be a simple matter for America to stay out of it. American commercial interests, selfish and greedy, sensing the opportunity for profit from war, would do as they have done in the past, if left to pursue their own course.
Ultimately, the Nye Committee leads to a series of laws, the Neutrality Acts, that are passed in the middle 30s, varying limits of what can be done by the president. So FDR can't loan money for Britain to buy guns. We can't deliver guns or whatever to Britain. Nye, he was a newspaper man, and he probably knows better than pretty much anybody how to manipulate the press. In the United States, we don't usually think about an anti-war movement until, you know, like the 1960s with the Vietnam War. But in the latter 20s and into the early 30s, there's a very strong anti-war movement.
The arms embargo is far too great a security. to American peace to permit its surrender without a last-ditch fight.
Nye was not playing a game. He wasn't doing the suave debate. He was more hammering that we don't need to be there or we shouldn't be there. He seems to have set his mind on that particular element and even got Dr. Seuss's attention. He does caricatures of Gerald Nye and his ranting and raving. He's catching attention, but I don't think it's the attention he wanted, or wasn't the attention that was going to make him successful. The story goes that he's giving a speech and someone hands him a note that says, "Japanese just bombed Pearl Harbor." And he looks at it and keeps on with his speech against war and against how Roosevelt was going to drag us into this war. And you know, somebody you know, like slaps him again and hands him the note, and he keeps on speaking against the war. And then a few hours later, you know, President Roosevelt is declaring war. He supports the Second World War after it comes, but by the time the Japanese attack Pearl Harbor, he's become irrelevant.
Prairie Mosaic is funded by the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund with money from the vote of the people of Minnesota on November 4, 2008, the North Dakota Council on the Arts, and by the members of Prairie Public.